Hello and welcome to this presentation on the chemistry-based solidification model that was recently released in FLOW-3D cast version 5.1. So before we get started, let's do a couple of announcements, and we are very happy. We will be in Munich next summer in Germany, June 7th to 9th for the World User Conference 2021. We are delighted to have a keynote speaker, Hubert Lang from BMW, and we will also have a whole host of presentations from various users around the world. And so by all means, please do submit your abstracts. We look forward to seeing you there. It's always a great time, a lot of different applications, including casting, of course, and we will be able to see what everybody has been up to during this period. So we're looking forward to that, and we will see you hopefully in June. It's never too early to book this on your travel calendar. Also, we have introduced metal casting workshops. So if you go to our website, flow3d.com, and then just look for workshops metal casting, what you will see is that we have now some online workshops. These are very effective ways of introducing the software to new users. It consists of a 3-hour training, and after that training you have access to a Flow 3D cast license for a period of 30 days so that you can explore the tool in more depth and how it might fit in your workflow. So currently these workshops are for the US and Canada only. If you would like a workshop in your own territory, please just email us and we can put you in touch with a representative and associate in your part of the world. So for the US and Canada, the next workshop is September 24th. Go to our website and register. It's a very well priced, and you will get some free training and a 30-day license to go with it. Okay, so let's see. So any questions, please email webdemo@flow3d.com, and we call this web demo because in fact questions are always in fact a technical conversation, and once you've had that technical conversation, it may be appropriate to schedule a demonstration. And generally speaking, what we want to do is to be able to understand your application, your challenges, and then see how that connects with the capabilities that are offered in Flow 3D Cast. So the agenda for today will be a brief introduction to flow science, very brief, and then also a very brief presentation of the Flow 3D Cast 5.1 modeling platform. So there was a presentation on the release of 5.1, everything that's in 5.1 earlier this summer. You can download this from our website. So I'm not going to redo everything that was done in that earlier presentation. Rather, today I'm going to focus on the chemistry-based solidification model, which is a major new feature in 5.1 and kind of warrants its own presentation. So there'll be a model description, wedge casting example, model implementation in Flow 3D Cast V5.1. So how is this? How does this work in practice when you open Flow 3D? And then we have a couple more validation cases with a step casting and a triple wedge casting example. So we have some measurements, and we'll show you how the model matches those measurements. Okay. So a little bit about flow science. Our origins, if you like, are with the Los Alamos National Lab, some of the early pioneers of computational fluid dynamics. In particular, the volume of fluid method was developed at that time, and that is the technology that we still deploy today, although it's a more advanced form of that seminal work done by Dr. Tony Hurt and his colleagues. Flow Science was founded in 1980. The commercial version of Flow 3D was released in 1985. And you can see a little bit of the evolution of the user interface and what results look like between, let's say, 1996, 1998, and then now in 2020. can see some just amazing high fidelity representations of the flow for metal casting applications and for free surface flows in general. As another example, just to show you how far we've come with these applications, this is a kind of early freeze low pressure die casting example. What you're going to see is almost a mirror image perfection of the model compared to what was observed in the shop. Okay, so I like to show this picture because it's just exemplifies how far we've come in terms of module accuracy and being able to predict fill detail and some of the defects that can occur during that stage. So today we have offices all around the world. We are headquartered in Santa Fe, New Mexico, with major applications, of course, metal casting, also additive manufacturing and welding, aerospace, microfluidics, water civil infrastructure, coating, and really anything that has a free surface. That's kind of the realm where we operate, and we've been heavily focused on casting for a good 30 years now. So we have a lot of in-house expertise and application-specific support, so casting support engineers, and then a team of dedicated metal casting developers. That's how we make progress with this. Okay, so that was just a brief introduction to the kind of origins and where we are today with Flow Science. And then let's talk a little bit about briefly about Flow 3D Cast V5.1. So the release webinar I mentioned earlier on has a lot of information. So if you visit the website, products, Flow 3D Cast and Flow 3D Cast webinars, you'll be able to find that presentation. It's a whole review of what was included in release 5.1. So I encourage you to review that webinar if you haven't already done that. Just navigate to that particular presentation, Cast V5.1, and you'll have a lot of information. So we like to think of Cast 5.1 as a complete modeling tool. Why? Because we have a vast array of available physics, a vast array of process models, which means we can model the simplest to the most complex casting applications. In addition to all that kind of modeling power, we have developed a highly intuitive and streamlined user interface. And to help with the kind of variety that exists within the casting world, we've also developed 11 process workspaces. And process workspaces preload all the models, all the physics, all the settings needed for your day-to-day modeling needs. But we do that in a way that's focused on a specific process. So HPDC, LPDC, gravity die casting, etc. It's all metal casting, but at the same time, the details are all very different between the different applications. You use different physics models, different settings, different outputs. So we preload those for you so that if you are, let's say, an HPDC modeler, you have everything kind of laid out for you in your HPDC process workspace. So I'll show you that in a little bit. And then we also have, accompanying the release, a complete set of video tutorials for each of these processes. So this really helps you very quickly get up to speed, understand what you're doing, and make the most out of your modeling journey. Okay. And then to help you, industry-leading support from experts, metal casting modelers. Okay. Casting is one of the applications, maybe, which has potentially at least some of the most challenging simulation computational needs. So we've made high performance computing an integral part of our solution for casting applications. You can do that on the cloud, you can do that through high performance computing, parallel computing, if you have your own cluster, but all this is seamless in the way we do things for metal casting. So the modeling platform looks something like this. In fact, it looks exactly like this. This is a foam, lost foam example, and what we have here on the left is a process toolbar. And what you can think about think of this as follow the guide kind of direction here, where you start with global parameters, time parameters, the models you want to use, the geometry, the mesh, the boundaries, etc. And you just follow this guide step by step. That's what we try and do for you. And what this results in is a model set up that is sequential, step by step, follow the guide. And we've also removed things that you don't need to be seeing for your specific application. So what you see, WYSIWYN, what you see is what you need, is also part of the design philosophy for this interface. So you'll start with the parts. So you'll need a CAD representation. You'll bring this into Flow 3D Cast. You will start creating your model. From your model, you will run an analysis, and you hopefully will be able to achieve an improved design. So there's always, almost always, some iteration that happens between the model, the analysis, some changes in the process parameters, so new analysis, and so on. And by a kind of iterative process, you will normally get land in a place where you have a fault-free design. Okay, so that's the kind of general process. And then more in more detail here, if you look at the process toolbar I mentioned on, and you go down the line, so for instance, you'll start with your global parameters. So what are we doing? The process type is investment casting in this example, and then the sub-process is solidification. So we're doing the solidification of an investment casting application with carbon steel. Fine. So that's a global global kind of description of the problem. Then we have time control. So we, in this case, we are, if you're doing a solidification, we are restarting from a previous fill most of the time. So we are restarting from a previous simulation, and then we don't know how long this is going to take to solidify, but we'll find out soon enough. But that's why we have some time controls there. And then we have some models that read physical models, and we have turned on everything for you that you need for this specific type of application. So gravity is on, of course. I'll show you how this all works in a minute, model wise but the next step would be the geometry. So you would want to create a shell mold. So we preloaded everything you need to create a shell mold for your investment casting process. So here's an example of some geometry. You're going to create a shell around it through the shell creation tool, and continue your work. So the process workspace, we have 11 of them that cover pretty much everything that's there in the kind of common processes in the foundry: centrifugal casting, continuous casting, gravity, HPDC, investment, lost foam, tilt pour, etc. So from there we have 11 process workspaces, and this is how they are represented on the website. So if you go to the website, you can read more about all these different individual process workspaces. Okay, flow3d.com, products, and then flow3d cast. Each one of these has, as I mentioned, preloaded geometry types. So if you're doing HPDC or die casting, you'll have cooling channels. You may have filters in some cases. You may have shell molds, components for investment casting. So we preload those geometry types and the databases that go with them, depending on your application. We will preload process-specific defaults, so the appropriate physical model, the appropriate model settings, and all of this collectively creates a simulation setup that's intuitive, quick, and ultimately successful. That's what we are trying to deliver for you. So let's take a more detailed example. You have an investment casting. You'll choose this process workspace. You will choose the sub-process type, in this case solidification. And then what we've done, for instance, is we've preloaded the radiation model because you are doing investment casting. So that's pre-selected. We have pre-selected the outputs that you will need for this type of application. We have preloaded the types of geometry that you will need, in this case shell molds. With the kind of WYSIWYN idea, we've removed things you don't need and we've kept the things you do need. So that makes everything very streamlined and simple as a matter of setup and analysis for the user. Okay, so more information on the website. Just done a lot of good information, plenty of examples, and you can look at all the different workspaces that are available for you. Okay, if you would like to see for yourself, by far the best way to do this is to attend the workshop. Why? Because you will be able to be trained for 3 hours, and then you'll have a license for yourself to run for 30 days. So this is for new users, so people who are wanting to get up to speed with up to date with how these things work. The next workshop, there's one on September 10 and then one on September 24th as well. If you go to the website, you'll be able to register. And we are always updating these workshops, so there'll be more in the future. More dates will come up throughout the year and next year. Okay, so that was a kind of general presentation of where we are with our tool, and what I'd like to do now is focus more on the chemistry-based solidification model. So a reference paper here that's very well written and very interesting. It's the best paper award, in fact, from 2019, the AFS Aluminum and Light Metals Division, from Dr. Catalina and Doctors Monroe, Foley and Griffin, University of Alabama. So modeling and simulation of microstructure and mechanical properties of aluminum, silicon and copper-based alloy. So that's a reference paper. I encourage you to take a look for a lot of this work. And if we want to give maybe a high-level overview of what this model achieves, we can say that microstructural features, so grain size, we call them GS, in this presentation, and the secondary dendrite arm spacing, SDAS, are generally controlled by the local chemical composition of the alloy and the local temperature and cooling conditions. So one aspect is to be cognizant of how microstructural features develop. So we have a control by local chemical composition, local temperature and local cooling conditions. And in turn, mechanical properties of the cast component depend on those microstructural features that develop during the solidification process. So it turns out that the ultimate tensile strength and the yield strength, so the mechanical properties, can be predicted provided that the elongation to failure and the strength coefficients and the strain hardening exponent N can be evaluated. So there is a relationship between K, N, and the elongation to failure. So keeping in mind that K and N are related to the quality of the metal and process. So it's influenced by what's happening in the foundry. So degassing, pressure conditioned, filters, treatment of oxides, reuse of alloy, alloy quality. All those will have an impact on K and N. And that is just part of how things are in terms of the development of mechanical properties. So keep that in mind. However, the elongation to failure can be predicted depending on the alloy, either mainly based on the secondary dendrite arm spacing or on the grain size. So that is one aspect that is very important, because if you can predict the grain size or the SDAS, then you have a path to predicting the elongation of failure to failure. And if you have information about the process in your foundry that relates to K and N, then you have a way to get to mechanical properties as a model prediction. So that's a very kind of nice roadmap here to get to mechanical properties based on thermodynamic reactions and cooling and local cooling and local temperature in the alloy. So what we do here with FLOW-3D cast finally is predict the grain size and the secondary dendrite arm spacing by tracking thermodynamic reactions of different alloys. And from there, we are able to make progress towards mechanical property prediction. So another way of kind of repeating the same thing, but just a little bit differently. If you think about solidification evolution, we have microsegregation and thermodynamic equilibrium at the liquid-solid interface. So that's happening at that interface. We have macrosegregation happening due to advection if the metal is moving, and diffusion of the alloy compounds as well. And we have temperature and the chemical composition evolution. So all of this kind of determines the evolution of solidification, and all of these things are things we can track with the solver. After that, microstructure is controlled by SDAS grain size. That's how we we are tracking based on thermodynamic reactions of the different alloys, and from there you get to mechanical properties. So I'm repeating the same thing that I did in the previous slide, but just stated a little bit differently. And again, it's very important to understand that K and N are related to the quality of the metal and the process, the actual process that's happening in the foundry. So once you have all that, basically what we are saying is, or what we are doing in Flow-3D, is keeping track of all those reactions. And from those reactions, we are able to get a handle on the microstructure. And from the microstructure, we are able to get to mechanical properties. So we can summarize this on a high level kind of description of the model. The new solidification model is a quantitative predictive tool for microstructure evolution at the moment for aluminum silicon and aluminum copper alloys. And then we use empirical relationships to relate that information to mechanical properties. So that's the kind of sequence of solving this problem. We predict grain size, and then we use that spatial map of the microstructure, and that's the basis for accurate mechanical properties. Okay, what's also nice as a kind of side almost a byproduct of this analysis is that now we can also compute a non-dimensional Nyama criterion, which improves our prediction of porosity. So a lot of good things tied into this approach to modeling the microstructure. Talking about Nyama criterion, previously we had just a general sense of the smaller the criterion, the more likely we were to have porosity, but it didn't give any information on the amount of porosity. The dimensionless Nyama criterion allows, in fact, for that quantification, the computation of the amount of microporosity. So what we have, for instance, as an example here, we have a temperature gradient, we have the cooling rate. Put those two together, you're able to compute the Nyama criterion. But now what we can do in addition is, based on the additional information we have, calculate the dimensionless Nyama criterion, which will actually give you a quantitative prediction of the microporosity for the dimensionless from the dimensionless Nyama. Okay, so of course we are obsessed, I suppose, with accuracy, and one thing to remind all our users is that, of course, the cooling rates in these analyses, so everything is based on the local temperature condition and the local cooling rate conditions, and in order to have those accurately described in your model, the heat transfer coefficients are completely foundational. So you need to have correct cooling curves. Too fast or too slow affects your microstructure, primary solidification range, grain size, SDAS, etc. So the accurate heat transfer coefficient representation is of primary importance. Also of primary importance is the accurate knowledge of alloy composition. And if you are trying to get to mechanical properties in addition to just the microstructural properties, if you want to get to those mechanical properties in addition, you have to have knowledge of the metal quality, so those K and N parameters that I mentioned. So these are affected by what's happening in your process, as I mentioned, degassing, pressure, oxide film remedial, etc. So the best way, most robust way of getting at this is to, in fact, get some witness samples from your specific metal in your foundry. That's the simplest way to do it. Okay, so let's give some thought to a wedge casting example. So wedge shape experimental samples, we have some samples that were produced by the University of Alabama in Birmingham. And this example uses an aluminum A356 alloy. And what we wanted to do is compare basically experiments with the prediction of our tool. So commercial ingots A356 has the description kind of for reference of the experiment. This was solidification happened in a pressurized fashion in this case, and we have thermocouples, three thermocouples that recorded the temperature. So the sample was then sliced into different parts, and then mechanical tests were done on all of the samples. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The alloy we used is the 356. It was also heat treated after solidification. Okay. So what we'll do is we set this up in Flow-3D CAS. It's actually a completely trivial model to set up. It's just a geometry with a die around it. And the full chemistry model was used in order to demonstrate the full capability of the new solidification model. So this is just a button that you click, a full chemistry based solidification model that's in the solidification kind of options in your model section. And then we also entered our properties for K and N, and then the full chemistry model. So that's the K and N is for the mechanical properties, and the diffusion and macro segregation, those are captured by using the full chemistry based solidification model. So we entered all that information, and we also included advection for completeness, so shrinkage with flow effects. So we did the most kind of chose the most complete representation of the solution. What you also need to do is enter your alloy solidification data, which is an alloy property, and you also need to enter your chemical composition, because this is, we are tracking chemical compositions after all, so we need to know the initial content of different compounds that are in the alloy. So we have silicon, weight percentages, copper, magnesium, etc. So those are, that's data that you need to enter into your model. And basically just represent the data back into the model. So what we also need is some data which is foundry specific for your mechanical properties. So you can either use some coefficients, or you can use, you could alternatively also use just witness sample elongation, witness sample yield strength, witness sample ultimate tensile strength. So if you have some samples from your process that you can get some mechanical properties for, you can then apply those numbers, and that is also a very straightforward way of doing this. Okay. So we start with the cooling curves. We want to, I said that the heat transfer coefficients were completely foundational. So we want to make sure that our HTCs are representing the correct cooling. And so, yes, we are able to get an extremely good representation of the cooling at the temperature profiles at different thermocouples. So that's kind of the first step to make sure we're doing well there. And then what we are able to do is basically look at the outputs of our simulation, look at the secondary dendriton spacing, and compare that with the experimental data. So you can see very, very good agreements between the predictions of the Flow-3D CAST chemistry-based model and what is found in the sample specimens. We can also look at the microporosity. I had mentioned this was vastly improved using the dimensionless Nyamak criterion. So now we are able to get some very nice agreements between experimental data and simulated data, except for a couple of outliers near the very top where there's other things going on with large-scale porosity. So those are kind of outside of this picture, but up to 100 and up to the, you know, samples 6, 7, we are in very, very good shape. And then at the end of this, we are able to also get some mechanical properties, so the elongation and the distance from the bottom of the casting hair. Again, some excellent agreements between the simulated and experimental data. Okay. And the last one here, the ultimate tensile strength for mechanical properties, also besides those two outliers at the very top of the casting, excellent agreements between ultimate tensile strength and what is predicted by the model. So a first example that is very, very encouraging. I'll come back to two more examples a little bit later on in the presentation. So how do you do this in Flow-3D Cast? So this, you have two ways of doing this. So the standard model, you would provide the solidification path. So solid fraction versus temperature and material properties, and they're all predefined. They don't vary in time and space. So this gives you an idea of the arm spacing, but it's all relative values. So it's not really as useful as it could be when you want to try to get to those mechanical properties. So, but you would still use that for alloys that are not covered currently in the chemistry-based model. So at the moment we have aluminum, copper and silicon models in there, and over time we are adding other alloys, ferrous alloys, new aluminum alloys, other high-performance alloys are all coming online over the next few releases. But for now, if you do have a copper or a silicon aluminum alloy, then you would use the chemistry-based model. And now what's happening is that the solidification path and material properties are dynamically computed. That's what's so important. Dynamically computed, considering the nucleation, segregation, and cooling conditions spatially and in time at every part of your model, of your casting part. So there's a spatial map that's evolving with time. So it's a very detailed dynamic map of your solidification path. So this gives us macro segregation, absolute values of secondary dendrite arm spacing and grain size, mechanical properties, and dimensionless Nyamak criterion for porosity. So a very advanced model, and that is the model you should be using when you are dealing with aluminum, copper or silicon alloys. It's vastly improved on the standard model. Okay, so within the chemistry-based model you have two options. So one is the full model, and in this model we are considering convective flow, diffusion and cooling conditions. We are kind of considering everything that could possibly happen in terms of how alloys are moving around within the alloy as it solidifies. And you have another one, which is a simplified model, which is still entirely appropriate to predict microstructures and mechanical properties in the cases where you do not have convective flow. So thin alloys, thin cross sections. For those cases, rule of thumb, you're completely within your rights to use the simplified chemistry-based solidification model, and you will still get excellent results because convection is not so important. So you'll use the full model with bulkier parts or also slow cooling conditions where diffusion could actually have an effect. In the other case, when you have thin parts or rapid cooling, you would use the simplified model with no loss of accuracy, just to be clear. It's because the processes of convection and diffusion are actually not important, not relevant, and so you don't need to be modeling those. There's just no good reason to do that. So with thin parts, rapid cooling, use the simplified model. With bulkier parts, slow cooling, use the full model. That's the take-home message. Okay. So the inputs that you need, material properties, of course, I showed you this a little bit earlier on, solid is temperature, liquid is temperature, those sorts of things. The chemical alloy composition is something that you will need to enter, of course, you need to know that. And then those strength and strain hardening exponent and strength coefficients, or one or the other, or the witness sample data that you have from your foundry. So these are process specific, meaning foundry specific, how you go about pouring your metal and solidifying your metal. And we can't model that in any other way than you telling us what you do, how you do it, and then we are able to get those exponents. Other inputs in the actual model in the solidification tab, you have to turn this on. So you can either use the full chemistry-based solidification, the chemistry-based solidification. These are some of the options, K, N, macro segregation. You have to think about that. If it's important, use the full chemistry. If it's not, use the simplified chemistry. And if advection is important, model with flow effects or without. Okay, and if you are not using aluminum alloys, or at least not aluminum, copper or silicon alloys, you will have to use the tabular based regular model that we have. The outputs from this model are the element composition, phase formation, macro segregation, cooling rate, solidification time, grain size, SDAS, dimensionless Niama, and then the mechanical properties, and also mechanical properties after heat treatment. So all of this is are outputs from your model. And what's important to know is that even if you're ignoring mechanical properties, the model delivers increased accuracy for porosity regions and shrinkage. So let's see what this looks like on a second example here. We have a stepped wedge. It's a silicon alloy. Some details here on the actual die and the process of pouring this. What we'll see here is we are going to be able to extract the average experimental values and the mechanical properties. So for the arm spacing, microstructure, for the mechanical properties, and we're going to compare those to the numerical model. So let's take a look. The numerical model, which is die casting. So we did some thermal die cycling in the best part of the analysis. So you'll do a number of cycles, in this case 20 cycles of thermal die cycling, to make sure that you're basically starting with the correct temperature distribution. I mentioned that heat transfer coefficients were foundational to getting a good model, whereas also starting with the correct thermal die cycling picture for your mold. So we do that. And what we are able to compare then is your experimental data with the thermocouples. So in this case, you can look on the left picture to the secondary dendrite arm spacing, in the middle, the ultimate tensile strength, and elongation to fracture on the right. So in general, just as a kind of quick look there, in the red are the thermocouples, and in black are the data from FLOW-3D CAD. So, you know, look, let's say at the SDAS, I'm looking at the top left corner, 25, 25.6, 23.5, 23.3, 29, 23.9, 21, 16.4 on the lower wedge, somewhere around 14.8, 15.2. So really excellent agreement. And then same thing with the UTS and with the elongation to fracture. Really very, very encouraging results. If you want to look at these in a kind of a simpler way here, on the right we have a comparison between the measured and simulated average SDAS in the various sections of the casting. So for sections A, B, C, D, E, which are going up through the casting, really some excellent agreements on the arm spacing data. And then also excellent agreements between, for the different wedges there, between the UTS and the experimental and the simulation data, really excellent. So again, another example here that's showing just how promising this model is, and we are eager to get your feedback when you use this model for your own aluminum, copper or silicon casting pasts. Then a final example here, the triple wedge casting. So this is from a thesis, 2016, and it's kind of a very similar kind of setup, where we have three wedge castings in this case, and we are also extracting each wedge casting. We're extracting the microstructure analysis and tensile tests. So the FLOW-3D cast model looks like this. And again, those cooling curves, we want to get those spot on and some excellent agreement here between the experimental data and the simulation. As for the third wedge, the first two wedges, left and right, and then the output that you get from the model. You basically do all of the same steps that we had mentioned earlier. You input the chemistry, composition, chemical composition, set up your model, run it, and then you get your output. So the this is the what the output for the arm spacing looks like. Porosity, I mentioned that we had this dimensionless Naama criterion now, which gives you a very good prediction of porosity. So we use that, elongation to fracture, and the ultimate tensile strength, so the mechanical properties. So now we look at this result. Still excellent, a little bit on the kind of fringes of the experimental uncertainty compared to the other two maybe, but still very, very comforting. The experimental versus simulation for the porosity is excellent, and same for the UTS prediction, experimental versus simulation, also really, really excellent. So before we wrap this up, I wanted to have one slide on the key ingredients for modeling success. And number one, I think universally, is a good grasp of the heat transfer coefficients you should be using for your specific casting process. It's really foundational to have a good handle on your heat transfer coefficients. So it can be through the database, or even better, through refinements, through your own experience and your own specific processes. So pay attention to heat transfer coefficients. It's really important. Then make full use of the process models that are available in FLOW-3D CAST. So FLOW-3D CAST is a high fidelity modeling tool. So take advantage of that. And the more you model, yes, there's more complexity, but there's also more representation of the physics that are actually happening. So make use of what's available there in FLOW-3D CAST. And then in terms of this specific model, determine, it's important to try and get an understanding of whether macro segregation is or not important, because that will affect your choice of using the full versus the simplified chemistry-based solidification model. The simplified one runs quite a bit faster than the full one. So if you can use the simplified chemistry-based solidification model, you should. And by and large, if you have rapid cooling rates, thin parts, you should be using the simplified one. If you have bulky parts with or possibly low slow solidification rates, which might allow for substantial meaningful diffusion, then you should use the full model. And then if you are looking for mechanical properties, you need to be able to characterize what's happening in your foundry, the way you pour your metal. So sample witness is really the best way to do it. Otherwise, you can use these coefficients K and N if you don't have sample witness data. So those are the three examples that I wanted to show you today. We continue to work on more complex parts, and we will release those validations as we make progress through those parts over the coming months and years to come. So what I hope you took home from this is that we have been able to deliver in FLOW-3D CAST V5.1 a profoundly improved solidification model that is now chemistry-based, based on the dynamics, the local dynamics of the temperature and thermodynamic equilibrium, the cooling rate evolution, the temperature evolution, the chemical composition evolution, by keeping those reactions, by tracking those reactions in time and space, we are able to deliver a prediction of the microstructure that's truly determined by the local dynamic conditions of the metal as it solidifies. So that's really a sophisticated way of doing this. It's very physics based and very accurate. So that is what is delivered from the solver's perspective, and using that macrostructure map, we are able to then use empirical relationships to get to mechanical properties, as long as you have knowledge of how your metal is being poured and solidified in your foundry. So immense progress, and it's, I think, a very good reason, for good reasons, that the paper won the AFS Paper of the Year award in 2019. It really is excellent work done by our developers. The new model currently handles silicon and copper aluminum alloys. You need to be well aware of this, and we are adding extra alloys. These will be released over the coming releases of Flow3D Cast, and then other alloy developments are underway. Okay, so that's what I was hoping to share with you today. We look forward to you using this model and sharing with us your results. And any questions, of course, please email us webdemo@flow3d.com. Thank you for your attention. Goodbye.